Macmillan Audio presents Why You Like It, The Science and Culture of Musical Taste by Nolan Gasser. Read for you by the author. Preface. When I was 23, my buddy Glenn Georgiev and I sold all of our belongings and flew to Paris, where I spent the next 2 years studying composition, playing jazz, and searching for answers to questions I hadn't quite yet formulated. By the end of the first year, we'd built up a pretty good circle of friends, mainly other expats, but also a few bon Parisiens. During one of our regular dinner soirees, one of our French friends stood up, a few glasses of Beaujolais in, and proposed a game where she would go around the room and align each person with a literary genre that matched their personality. To Glenn, at that moment, an aspiring novelist with bohemian tendencies, she tagged un roman, a novel. To another, a rather quirky and colorful girl in our company, she assigned a haiku. She then turned to me and stared a while. Finally, she said, "I've got it. You're an encyclopedia." In truth, I felt a bit insulted. As the one active artist in the bunch, shouldn't I be aligned with something more romantic, more aesthetic? I don't know, maybe a sonnet or an epic poem? And while I still think I got shortchanged in my literary nom de guerre, I must admit that there was and is truth there. Beyond my creative aspirations, I've always been prone to want to see the bigger picture, the story behind the story, the history that gives rise to the present reality. And so, as cliched as it sounds, this book is literally decades in the making, a chance for me to be encyclopedic for a change, to wax comprehensive about the topic that has defined me since I first plucked out three blind mice on the piano by ear at the age of 4, music. In the years since Paris, I've managed to successfully formulate a good many of the questions I couldn't quite articulate in my youth. I've even managed to find a few satisfying answers about music, if not about life in general. This book offers the most comprehensive evidence to this former claim, my best attempt to explain not just what music is, but why it matters to us. Enabling my audacity to tell this story have been a few facts along the way. The first is my lifelong commitment to music education. Formally, via a bachelor's degree in piano and composition, a master's degree in composition, and a PhD in musicology, and informally, via perpetual self-study in myriad music-intersecting disciplines: history, philosophy, physics, neuroscience, sociology, and psychology. The second source of this audacity is my similarly eclectic approach as a composer and pianist, working across multiple styles or species, as I'll soon label them, from practically my earliest attempts. Even today, most of my compositional and performance efforts will inevitably involve mixing a bit of this style and a bit of that style, in search of some fresh musical expression. The third and perhaps most consequential source in enabling this book is the good fortune I gained in 2000, when I was tapped to be the chief musicologist for a tech startup, the company now called Pandora. Never would I have predicted in 2000 that this company and its music genome project, of which I am the architect, would become so widely utilized by music lovers throughout the U.S. and beyond, and so influential in the digital music revolution of the early 2000s. This fortuitous opportunity has no doubt given me the bona fides to write a book about musical taste. But more practically, my work at Pandora enabled me to dig into all realms of music more deeply than I would have otherwise. It forced me to approach music analysis and musicology in ways I hadn't previously, and it allowed me to confront headlong a profound mystery I hadn't even considered before. What is musical taste, and where does it come from? Indeed, I liken this book to a mystery novel, a musical whodunit, Only at the end will you truly know the whys and wherefores of your musical taste. Why You Like It is indeed about musical taste, but it also touches upon many other subjects that skirt along its edges. As I like to say, discussing musical taste gives me the opportunity to talk about music in general, since every dimension of music, its history, theory, practice, aesthetics, science, culture, psychology, etc., impacts what music we like and why we like it. While this presents terrific opportunities for an encyclopedic guy like me, it also poses serious challenges, not least the daunting need to synthesize and explain everything related to music. This accounts for the wide scope of topics tackled in this book, for better or worse. Yet to the degree that I've succeeded in my efforts, this broad approach affords a potentially rich bounty to lay non-musician readers of this book, to not only better understand their musical taste, but also to heighten, even change, how they listen to and think about music. This is the case, moreover, whether your tastes are limited to the boundaries of pop, rock, jazz, hip-hop, electronica, world music, or classical, or whether, like me, they transcend multiple musical domains. This book is first and foremost aimed at the average music lover, not the trained musician. To be fair, it skews a bit toward those with a modicum of musical background, having taken piano lessons as a child, for example. It should also be noted that this book cites the names of lots and lots of musicians and composers from every era and genre. While in many cases these names will be accompanied by a brief contextual description, in many others they will not, namely when the person is particularly prominent within the genre in question. If you encounter a standalone name you are unfamiliar with, do not panic. You are instead kindly invited to look it up on Wikipedia and so forth. After all, learning more about famous musicians should be a welcome goal of anyone exploring musical taste. However, rest assured that prior musical training is not a prerequisite, nor is this book aimed at academics or professionals in the fields of anthropology, physics, neuroscience, sociology, or psychology. Although some broad awareness in one or more of these fields won't hurt. At the same time, it is my sincere hope that professional musicians, as well as academics in science, sociology, or psychology, will gain something of value from this book. I know I did in researching and writing it. There is, of course, a rich tradition of technical books about music written by musicians, including composers, aimed at lay readers. Standing in the wake of related efforts by giants like Leonard Bernstein, The Joy of Music, The Unanswered Questions, Six Talks at Harvard, Aaron Copland, What to Listen for in Music, and Virgil Thompson, The Art of Judging Music, not to mention celebrated academics like Dan Levitin, Elizabeth Margulis, and David Huron, I am humbled and a bit petrified. I've done my best to learn from their superb models in combining technical discussions with clear examples, personal stories, and humor. My apprehension in not living up to the high bar of my models, however, has been superseded by my passion to share this story of music and musical taste with those willing to pick up this book. For years, indeed, I would tell friends and strangers alike, "Someday I'm going to write a big book about music." Remarkably, that someday actually happened. Introduction: In the Ear of the Beholder. In reviewing a highly anticipated concert by the New York Philharmonic, a prominent New York music critic wrote the following: "This music is the dreariest kind of rubbish. Does anybody for a moment doubt that the composer would not write such chaotic, meaningless, cacophonous, ungrammatical stuff if he could invent a melody?" To whom is this offended music critic referring? Arnold Schoenberg, the father of atonal and 12-tone music? Karlheinz Stockhausen, the pioneer of post-World War II avant-garde classical music? John Cage, the guru of 1950s experimental music? Frank Zappa, the iconoclast of rock and classical sound collage? Actually, would you believe the critic was talking about Claude Debussy, the venerated composer of Clair de Lune? Those familiar with Nicholas Leninsky's Lexicon of Musical Invective, his entertaining anthology of critical assaults on the music of the great masters, will recognize that such vicious attacks of the past are commonly aimed at composers and works held today as the most critically acclaimed and widely beloved. In this case, the Dean of New York Music Critics, Henry Krebiel, was excoriating Debussy's orchestral tone poem, La Mer, in its American premiere in March 1907. Leninsky's lexicon is packed with such juicy epithets that today make us shake our heads in bemusement. Beethoven's symphonies are called hideous, injurious, and barbarous. Music by Brahms is labeled wanton, tiresome, and intolerable by no less than George Bernard Shaw. Mahler's works called grotesque, simplistic, and ponderous. Beyond the comfort that these now blasphemous rebukes offer a contemporary composer who receives a stinging review, they likewise display the general human tendency to recoil from the new and unfamiliar. Quote, "Music is an art in progress," Leninsky writes, "and what today is considered bizarre and unacceptable often becomes a prized model tomorrow." This is true, of course, not only of classical works of the 19th and 20th centuries, but extends back to Plato in his rails against the depravity of young kithara players in the 4th century BCE, and forward to a steady dismissal of virtually every musical movement of the last 100 years, from jazz to rock to hip-hop and beyond. Even the Beatles were deemed a catastrophe, a preposterous farrago of Valentine card romantic sentiments by Newsweek magazine in 1964. The takeaway in all this, however, is not just that critics often get it wrong, though they do, nor is it merely that time has a way of relegating initial critical assessments as comically short-sighted, though it often does. Another key point here is that opinions on music vary widely. That for myriad reasons, one person's favorite is another's rubbish. It may be that on his deathbed in 1923, Krebiel regretted his rash assessment of La Mer and now held it as a masterpiece, or that the Newsweek Beatle disparager later became the first on his block to buy Sgt. Pepper, though we'll likely never know in these cases. It actually is true, however, that Shaw later disavowed his attacks on Brahms, calling them my only mistake. But though it may, and often does, change over time, at any one moment, each of us has our own intensely personal and deeply felt musical taste. Indeed, there are many today, including those with advanced musical training, who dislike listening to Beethoven, too melodramatic, or Brahms, too dour, or Mahler, too sentimental, even if they can intellectually concede their genius and historical importance. Mark Twain's witty gem that Wagner's music is better than it sounds can probably apply to most of us in our preferred musical diet. Yeah, I know jazz is cool, but I just don't get it. Sure, everyone loves Bruce Springsteen, but I never liked his songs. My friends all love house music, but I find it annoying. I can hear you fill in your own version as I read this. The truth is that it's really only great music if it's great to you. Otherwise, it's like that movie that everyone raves about but which you found weak. You might not be surprised it won an Oscar, but you wouldn't want to watch it again. Without doubt, music has great power over us, and very few have ever been heard to utter the words, "I hate music." The music we love is a significant part of who we are, and the passion we feel toward our favorite songs, singers, bands, and composers is rivaled only by what we offer to our family and closest friends, if that. But why is this so? Why do we love some musical styles and dislike others? What does the music we love reveal about our personality? How can we discover more music that fits our musical profile? And why do some songs send shivers down our spine or put a spring in our step, while others leave us cold or put us in a foul mood? These are a few of the tantalizing questions regarding the sources, nature, and implications of our own personal musical taste that I will be tackling in this book. In the pages that follow, I will attempt to provide a framework through which we can begin to understand why we like the music we do. I will pursue this by relating music to a wide array of associated topics: mathematics, physics, neuroscience, biology, evolution, culture, sociology, and psychology, as well as delving into the technical aspects of the music itself. This may all seem a daunting exercise for both writer and reader, but such is necessary if we hope to properly understand our musical taste, our musical being. At the very least, this book will offer a colorful and eclectic exploration into the rich diversity of music and its surprisingly deep connections to the world around and within us. Beyond merely eliciting interesting information, however, it also, I hope, will explain how gaining a better understanding of our musical taste is a key to living a healthier and more productive life. Let's get started. What is musical taste? Before launching too deeply into the whys and wherefores of your musical taste, it will be useful to define exactly what is meant by the expression, at least in the context of this book. On a surface level, one's musical taste refers to the music that aligns with one's personal preferences, and hence the commonly used term musical preferences as a more formal equivalent, particularly in academic literature. We tend to listen to music that we like, that moves us positively on an emotional and/or intellectual level, and that generally makes us feel good more than we do music that has the opposite effect, or so we hope. And yet a good percentage of our musical interactions are hardly so straightforward or so directly tied to our conscious intentions. According to research by the social psychologists Matthias Mell and James Pennebaker, the average person listens to music about 14% of their waking lives, about the same as spent watching television, and about half as much as engaged in conversation. Assuming 8 hours of sleep, that's 2.5 hours a day, each and every day, or over 15 hours a week. For most of us, moreover, this number is drastically lower than our reality. Not all of this music, of course, is material we consciously select or even enjoy, and thus our musical barometer is constantly challenged and in need of calibration. For example, you start your day going to spin class at the gym and sweat to DJ mixes of hip-hop and pop tunes by Lil Jon, the Black Eyed Peas, Taylor Swift, and Michael Jackson. You drive to work and flip between radio stations playing classic rock by the Eagles, Steely Dan, and Lynyrd Skynyrd, and alt-rock songs by Panic at the Disco, The Killers, and Imagine Dragons. The lobby at work pipes in old-school R&B tunes by Al Green, Otis Redding, and Aretha Franklin. A run to the supermarket yields Standards by Frank Sinatra, Michael Bublé, and Etta James. And a dinner gathering with friends in an Italian restaurant provides a soundtrack of old standbys by Louis Prima, Luciano Pavarotti, and Dean Martin. Only then do you return home to put on a CD or digital playlist of your choice, perhaps Tchaikovsky or Maroon 5 or Fela Kuti, before retiring for the night. The hypothetical scenario above underscores the fact that for most of us, the music we listen to each day is a complex amalgam of voluntary and involuntary encounters, and is aligned with the many diverse contexts and circumstances of our daily lives. Practical, motivation at the gym; functional, getting to work; environmental, at the grocery store; social, at the restaurant; and leisure, choosing a CD at home, among others. As such, our musical taste is continually being engaged and queried.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.